up here? Oh, please sit down.
I saw this sitting on Tanya's desk, and this is my hero. And so he had to come out with me today because I'm like Julia yesterday and Jake, who their dog or somebody ate their notes, you know, like the teachers at school, you know, the dog ate my notes. Well, we don't have any notes. and Mrs. Dill, you know, usually has a plan. And Mrs. Dill has none today. But Jesus does. So I learned from my husband, you know, just trust that he will speak to you what these folks need to hear about us. So I said, okay. But I had to breathe. This is a picture of him.
Well, it has been our marriage. We'll soon be married 40 years. We've known each other. Oh, my.
Since kindergarten.
We started kindergarten together, but I don't really have much recollection of that. But when she started getting pretty, like in junior high, she kind of got my attention. And then we started dating in high school. And we really didn't date anyone else. It's totally contrary to what the world's going to tell you to do. I know in my life, I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for her. I look back and see how the Lord kind of used her to lasso me into service. Because I would probably, I'd have just ran. Just to be honest with you. I didn't know, you know, some people say they knew from when they were kids that they were called and they had this ministry. And if he was trying to tell me, I didn't want to hear it. I'm not going to say he didn't try to tell me. I just know that I didn't hear it and didn't want to. If it got kind of close sometimes, I'd just kind of just push it back just a little bit. Even when John asked me about ordination, I think, really? I know, Lord, you got better than this. So it's just been a journey that really has led us to more of Jesus than we knew was available. And there's still more. That's the thing that's most exciting about this, is that I feel like we've just kind of got started. Oh, really? And even in life, Kevin and Sarah talked about retirement. I don't even know that I even understand that word.
We love our jobs.
Yeah. Well, and not just that. And I don't know quite how to say this. We're big family people. Family's been very important to us. I have five sisters. You had?
I had three sisters and a brother.
A brother. And so family, blood family is just real important. But as we got thrown into the midst of the church, really, that's kind of how I see my life. I just got thrown. I see Mary Lou, and I think of John, her husband, who actually recognized that God was trying to do something in me. I look back, and I'm so very thankful for people like that, Lord have mercy, put me out here without telling me what to do or say. He would sit right there in the office door and just turn and grin as I said some of the stupidest crap. I mean, I look back on my life and I'm thinking, I still have the opportunity to do this? It just blows my mind.
Let me interject right here that this is the man that, when we were first married, he was an athlete. You know, I was a cheerleader, he was a ball player, and, you know, all of that in high school and stuff. And then after we got married, after dating 7 years, he still played softball, you know, in the summer, spring and summer and fall. And I enjoyed that. I loved watching him play. But, you know, we went to home church, and it was like, okay, this is home church night, but he was out on the tractor. Okay, so you go ahead and work, and I'll go. The ball game night, he'd get off the tractor and go play ball, but not go to home church. So, you know, I didn't quite get that. Didn't quite get it. But look at the man I have now. You know, he's a servant of the Lord, and I never dreamed I'd be married to a preacher. But it's okay. I love it.
There's a verse in, I think it's 1 Corinthians 1, it's 9 or 10, where it says, God is faithful. God is faithful, who has called us to fellowship with his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And, you know, a lot of us think because of our past, this is a reason we have a struggle with Jesus. And I have a cousin who... And I don't even know what denomination little church he goes to. But he has an opportunity every now and then to speak at in the Sunday school. And he said, and we got to talking. Of course, you know, if you're going to talk to me very long, we're going to end up talking about Jesus. And he said, you know, it's kind of interesting. We can talk about God a lot. But as soon as we talk about Jesus, people start getting strange and squirrely. Because Jesus is what makes the difference. It's at the name of Jesus. So when we go out there, we're putting Jesus out in front. Jesus is the game changer. We had, years ago, we did a teen camp, and we had Jesus is the answer. We didn't even know what that meant. I still don't know that I know what that means. But I know he is the answer to whatever is going on in life. He is the answer. So I don't know how much of this is going to be about marriage. I know Tanya wants me to share some stuff that she's told me for years that I needed to talk about. And, you know, certain things are easy for me to talk about. I don't mind putting my mistakes on display. I've talked about my stupidity and, you know, about
getting... Jesus saved him each time.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's another thing that I've really had to apologize for, especially the time that I got trapped on the tractor seat. I could see no Jesus in that. I'm just telling you. I was saved, yes, but my body felt like crap. It did. I mean, from somebody that's used to just picking up stuff and going to somebody that can't do it anymore, has to have his boys feed the cows because he can't carry the buckets. That's not me. And you know what? I hate to say this, that you guys that don't really know it, that pride is an issue that we all have to deal with. Yeah. And that's what that was all about, was pride. But when Tanya told me that I needed to go revisit that place where I had that accident, and that's when Jesus showed me some things. And finally, I got to the point where I could say, I know that it was you. And I know that I was called to speak for you. And I know that you sent your angels to break those bolts to get me off that seat. And there were some people that were smarter than me that didn't even go to church that told me the angels delivered me. They weren't people from this church. They were, and I don't even know if they ever go to church, but they said, well, the angels were really working for you. You know, I'm denying all this. I don't know if you guys have ever been through anything that you didn't really want to give God credit for because you wanted to do it yourself. I don't know how much of this is going to be about marriage, how much of it's, but hopefully it's all going to point you to Jesus, whether we talk about marriage. Because marriage, I'm working on the field. I get home at 2 Thursday morning.
I tried calling him before he gets into this.
Well, this is not any on her, okay, or on Tanya. I told Tanya before I came out here, you're going to hear some stuff you might think, uh-oh. No. She called and talked to Sue and asked her if we would teach on Sunday, and I wasn't home. She asked me on Friday morning. She said, Tanya called, wanted to know if you'd teach on. And I said, what? Normally, when she, I don't think I've ever said no. If I have, I don't remember it, but I don't think I've ever said no. But I kind of think if I'd have been home, I'd have said no this time. And I told somebody, I think it was Brent Joseph, I said, you know, I want to be up here like I want to drag my dead horse out of the field when he died. I'm just being honest here. I'm just telling you, I felt like I had nothing. And there's a responsibility when you're up here. To speak what he wants you to speak, and I'm thinking I'm not even connected now. No, I know none of you've ever been there, but that's where I was, and that's where I've been kind of till about 3 hours ago, or 4. But I knew I had to wrap my head around it. I just refused to do it. And I apologize to Sue, because I've probably treated her not too well the last couple of days. I don't know if part of that might have been you said yes and I'd have said no, and you know, I don't know. I don't know if that's that deep seated in here, but it might be. I don't know. But I'll say this, whenever Tanya asks you to do something, it's an opportunity for victory. Because whenever she asks, I've learned. Now, listen, I'm not going to put her up. She's not Jesus, so she might make a mistake or two. But when it comes to walking out and putting people around her in position of success, she's the best that I know of. She's the best that I've ever been around. And so I trust that. So I know. I don't know how I'm going to have success through this mess, but I know that it is available.
You ready for me to talk?
Yeah, go ahead.
Our journey with Jesus kind of started after we left our other church, where his name was at the end of prayers, but nowhere else. So I didn't really know him, and neither did he. He went to church growing up, and I went to the same church that we left, and you know, he loved me, so he went with me to mine, and you know, we kind of got involved in that. And but when we left, it was like, what do we do now? What do we do now? And Mike Nagel called us on the phone, asked us if we were okay. And we said we were. We were okay. And then, you know, we got with John and Mary Lou, and CFF was born. But I still continued on a search of my own, because my mom always listened to TV preachers. And I never did. I thought, I don't need that, because I know everything. If I don't know it, you know, I know somebody that does. You know, I didn't need them. But I started turning on Kenneth Copeland, and he delivered me. He delivered me from not believing the word, because I didn't believe the word anymore. And he delivered me from that. And then he led me to Creflo Dollar. And I got CDs from Creflo Dollar. I was like, oh my gosh. where have I been all of these years? And this guy is teaching this really cool stuff. And, I have play him in the kitchen, and Tom's walking through and getting freaked out about some things that he said. But, we just continue to listen and listen and listen. And, Kenneth Copeland's a big Jesus guy, and his daughter is even more so. And he'll lead you right into Jesus, and with faith. So that was really cool. And then Tom was on a mission for, because he saw grace in the Word, and just where does that all fit? We just didn't know where that all fit in. And then finally he watched one afternoon. I was in school, and he found Joseph Prince. And that man changed our lives from law to grace, from being under bondage to freedom. And he teaches Jesus like no one we've ever heard before. I mean, everything pointed to him, and I finally got to it, and Tom did too. He is everything. Jesus is everything. He is everything to us. And, I thank God for him. And so our lives took a big turn at that point. I mean, we were on the right track, and we understood a little bit about angels and how they worked in the unseen. We can't see them. I mean, some people see them. I've never seen one. I know they're at our house, though, because Tanya saw them there, Brent and Joseph saw them there, so, I'm pretty sure we got angels at our house, because they saved him I don't know how many times, but, and probably me, too, I just didn't know it, but the journey has been awesome. It's been hard sometimes, but I wouldn't give that hard road up for what we've gained through that. And our marriage got even better after we started seeking Jesus together. Oh, I made a rhyme. Mm-hmm. Our marriage got better when we started seeking Jesus together. And so, we still have our things, but life
is fun.
Like
the last 3 days, yeah.
But life is fun. And then, we're in the back room and the young people, and I heard my Taylor's voice giving a prophecy, and it's like brought me to tears. And then our other daughter, who is not really ours, but
yes,
Amanda,
she is.
Amanda, not
sorry,
my blood.
Jane, where
not my blood, but my spirit, because Amanda lived with us for a while. And then it's like, oh my gosh, pictures on the refrigerator. I mean, I still do that. Don't you do that? Did you do that with your kids? We got grandkids up there now, and some kids, but that was just, it melted my heart to see that my kids are after Jesus. And, it's been a fun journey. Hard, you go over some bumps and hit some potholes every once in a while. But I have to say, life is good. Life is good. But I'm expecting better.
One of the things that I have learned and been evident in life is, difficult times are going to come, and for me, a lot of that relates to my work, and 83 was really not a very good year, drought-wise, and the next thing that comes along is our first son. 88 was really awful. I mean, 88 was something, a drought that, like I'd never seen. People that loved me said, well, that was my believing. People that love you, you better be prepared. You better have a connection with Jesus that reaches past the people that you love. I'm just, and thankfully, even at that time, I knew that that was a lie. I knew that wasn't my faith out there. But after that year, 1988, we moved to our first, where we live now. God is bigger than any obstacle that the adversary puts out there. And what we need to do is when we see the obstacle, We need to look past the obstacle to see the victory on the other side. See, that's how God works, and that's how faith works. That's how he'll work in your marriages. That's how he'll work in your finances. Because what he wants us to do is bigger than what your job will supply. Get a hold of that. What he wants you to do is bigger than what your job will supply. So if you're not willing to step out to reach for the supernatural in provision, you're not going to be able to do all. I'm not going to say you can't do anything. Okay? Don't misunderstand me here. But there is more. Amen, there is more. He wants, what's the Bible say the reason is for a job?
To have to give that.
To do what?
Have to give to him that need him.
And provide for you?
No.
Oh, no, that's not what it says. Jesus said he supply all your need according to his. Jesus said he would supply. Jesus, one of these days we're going to get tired of not trying to believe what the scripture says. So if you're not there where you can believe what the scripture says, just say, you know what? This is bigger than me. Jesus, help me. Help me. I need Holy Spirit intervention here to get to the truth. Because the truth is bigger than what we have seen. He told Cyrus, who was a king in the Old Testament that was a Gentile king, he says, I'm going to give you the treasures of darkness and hidden riches of secret places that you will know that I'm God. And we, for somehow reason, why is that in the Bible?
For us.
Why is it in the Bible in 2 Kings where the this lady lost her husband, then made some financial, probably mistakes, because the creditor, evidently they might have been in debt, the creditor was going to come and take her kids and make them bond servants. Okay, and you're thinking, oh, put yourself in that situation, and in our life we just think, oh my God, we deserved it. We were dumb, we got in debt. Of course we can't receive the blessing of God because we haven't been doing his will. Nobody ever been there. Nobody ever been there. Well, this is this lady. Obviously, they made some family mistakes. The creditor was going to come and take the kids. And here comes the prophet. Now listen, people. We are all prophets if we'll speak the word of God. Now, we may not have been called to walk in the ministry of a prophet. But let me tell you, if you're speaking the word of God, you're prophesying to people, and speak the word of God to people so that they can be delivered, because it's what the word is what will bring deliverance. And what happened? She spoke to the prophet, and the prophet says, hey, got anything in your house? Well, we got a little oil. Go borrow vessels, and not a few. Now, what's she doing for this? What's her work part of it?
Doing what he said.
Being obedient to the word of the prophet. Not going out and getting another job. We'd all gone out and get 3 or 4 jobs. Right? Hey, Sarah. Isn't that what we'd have done? Where you at back there? Yeah, that's what we'd have done. Hey, I know she doesn't like it when I call her out like that, but hey. Get used to it, man.
I've done it.
Yeah.
Call her out.
But
she's working. She's working.
She's working. Amen. Yeah. But see, that's what we do. We rely on. Yeah. Amen. Hey, love you, Sarah. That's what we do as people. We try to provide for ourselves. So we're unwilling to tap into the supernatural where there is deliverance. And if that lady had been unwilling to tap into the supernatural, she'd have lost her
kids.
Listen now. God wants you to live blessed. He wanted them kids home. So he sent a prophet, and the prophet spoke a word. And she listened, and there was deliverance. And she didn't have to go get another job. She had enough and more. Because that's the God we serve. But if we are unwilling to look past the flesh to see in the supernatural, we're going to miss it. I'm not saying you can't have a good life. I'm not saying that God's grace isn't so, but there is more out there. And we should be running for more. We should be seeking for more. You know, a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. Are you just that man?
Yes.
I'm just that man. You're just that woman. Yes, we are. That's who he made this earth for. Right? For us. First of all, I think he kind of had Jesus in mind, you know. Yeah, because he said he, God so loved. Here I am, I'm going to work, and I'm hauling corn down to harvest land, and they asked me, I said, I won't be in this weekend. Well, what you got going on? I said, I got to go to a marriage conference. Actually, we're not calling a marriage conference, we're calling a relationship conference, because that's, you know, it's about relationships, and well, what you going to talk about? I said, I don't know. I said, everybody wants a formula. There ain't no formula for this. You know, I mean, everybody wants to, I said, I got nothing for that. That's not what this is. I don't know what I'm going to talk about. And the guy says, well, sounds to me like you kind of got your sermon there. And I said, and there's a lady that works there. And she says, well, it's about give and take. And I said, no, it's all about giving. If you want it about taking, don't get married. If you're interested in taking stuff, don't get married. If you're interested in giving everything you have, then get married. You need to be talking here.
I don't know how to follow that, though. Because he's a preacher, and I love it. We had started speaking the word out loud when our kids were little. And we have kind of stopped doing that a bit. We need to get that back on that, dear. But, you know, we would just quote those scriptures, like a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children. I mean, you know, we didn't have much. We have more now, but, you know, we didn't have much at the time when we were saying that. Because, you know, we want to leave an inheritance to our Lincoln and our peers. You know, they're our grandsons. And but speaking that word forth is important, you know, because faith comes by hearing the word of Christ. Faith comes that way. So if you don't really believe it right at first, the more you hear yourself saying it and getting in agreement with what the word of God says, the promises of Jesus, when we get in agreement with that alignment, like Julie was saying, we get our soul, our souls in alignment with that, we, you know, then we can see the fruit. Because remember, Romans 10:9 is you confess with your mouth and you do what?
Believe
in your heart. But if it's not in your heart just yet, you got to keep saying it. If you're not saying the things that you don't have, but that you want, if you're not saying it, there's nothing happening in the spirit realm. I believe that angels hearken unto the voice or the sound, that word is in Hebrew, the sound of the word. And I know God tells them what to do. Jesus tells them what to do. I, through speaking the word, tell them what to do. And we've had lots of experiences with angels. He was on the scaffolding one time. Well, and I didn't really talk to angels, really, but, you know, I was understanding more and more about them. You know, I listened to Kenneth Copeland, I listened to Gloria Copeland, I listened to Charles Capps, was awesome, teaching us about angels, and he started to fall from this scaffolding. We were building our big room, and he was up here working on something, and I was over here working on something else, and I yelled, Jesus, because that's, you know, as quick as that, you know, like that, he's falling, and I just yelled, Jesus, and Jesus saved him. I mean, he hit the floor, scaffolding piece fell on top of him, and the only injury he had was where he tried to save himself, where he grabbed hold of something, part of the scaffolding, maybe that was still standing, And that was the only injury he had, because he, you know, kind of hurt his hand a little bit. Wasn't it your hand?
No, I just had a little scratch on my arm.
On his arm.
I fell about 20 feet from the scaffolding to the hardwood floor. Yeah,
so,
right through the scaffolding. And the thing about it was, I was standing on a metal board. Yeah. And when I fell, I grabbed, and that pulled that off, and that actually landed on my head. We're talking a metal, I don't know.
Hardwood floor, too.
Well, yeah, but this metal scaffolding thing is probably
heavy. Yeah,
yeah, I don't know how much it weighs. And it landed right here, straight down, and it didn't leave a mark. Right, yeah.
But it was kind of like when that, I saw that piece come down on fall on him, but it was kind of like a little feather, beep, doo, you know, it just went boop, boop, and, you know, he was fine, he was okay. And so, you know, I believe the angels had a hand in that, that they were at work. And, you know, I was good, and I don't do it as much now, which I need to do more, but Psalm 91, you know, I would say that over our family, and I still do,
constantly.
Just not every day. I'll do that again, Lord. Thank you for reminding me. You know, that he gives his angels charge over us to keep us in all of our ways. You know, our stupid ways and our smart ways. You know, he keeps, you know, because we do stupid stuff. You know, I don't know, he did something else. I think he was like three times in 1 year he's hurting himself. And, you know, but he could have been severely injured. I believe, you know, even in the tractor incident, he could have died. But he didn't. And I believe because I don't know if he was, but I would pray that prayer of, thank you, Lord, for giving your angels charge over us, over Tom, over me, over Brett, over Carly, over Craig, over Taylor, to keep us in all of our ways. And he has. He has done that. He has kept us safe, you know, and it's dangerous out there in this world, right? You turn on the news and you hear it all. And it's dangerous. But we live in the secret place of the Most High. And it's not dangerous there. 1,000 shall fall at our side, and how many at our?
10,000.
10,000. I mean, that's a lot. That's a lot of people. But it's not going to come near us, because we are in that secret place, and we have those angels, and we have the Holy Spirit that guides, and we have Jesus right there. Jesus right there with us. And of course our Heavenly Father that is so loving that he gave us all of that. So speak the word. Speak it out loud just to yourself or to whoever's around. in whatever area, you know, just your favorite verses, you know, whatever you need, whatever in your heart's desire, because he gives you the desires of your heart, and he wants you to have those things.
And you know, through life, we have, as shared before, some difficult times, and you know, one spring was so wet I couldn't get anything planted, and it was heading towards the middle of June, and I remember walking in, just laying on the bed and crying. Because, you know, that's my work. That's how I take care of my family. At that time, she wasn't teaching. And and at that time, you know, I know I did my crying out to the Lord, but maybe not like I do today. And if you want, I know we don't like the word comfortable because we think it's a place, but he really kind of does want us comfortable. But it's a comfort in running to him. We take comfort in going to him through everything. I want to read, I know I'm going to go over just a little bit, but I just kind of feel like I need to read this record for some people. And Genesis 24, I think it's Genesis 24. And Abraham is sending out his servant. And we'll just 24:1. And Abraham was old and well stricken in age, and the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things. And Abraham said to his eldest servant of his house that ruled over all that he had. Now this is a big guy now. It's not just any servant. He puts the head guy out there. Put, I pray thee, thy hand under my thigh, and I will make thee swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of the earth, that thou shalt not take a wife unto my son of the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I dwell. See, God had called him out of his homeland, right, to dwell here. And he said, but he's not going to marry any of these people. But thou shalt go unto my country and to my kindred and take a wife unto my son Isaac. And the servant said unto him, peradventure the woman would not be willing to follow me into this land. this is a guy that wants to do what Abraham wants, but he knows he has no control over it. Right? This servant, he doesn't know if this girl's going to come back. He doesn't know the girl. Never met the girl. Had never seen the girl. He's going to a place he doesn't know anything about. Oh my, put yourself here. Golly gee whiz. That'd be quite a thing Abraham's asking this guy to do. Must I needs bring thy son again unto the land whence thou camest? And Abraham said unto him, beware. And I don't understand all the fullness of this, but he says, beware that thou bring not my son thither again. Don't take him back home. Don't take him back to my home. Don't do it again. The Lord God of heaven, which took me from my father's house and from the land of my kindred, which he spake unto me, that swear unto me, saying, unto thy seed will I give this land. He shall send his, what?
Angel
before thee, and thou shalt take a wife unto my son from thence. I've heard people say that they didn't think God was in their marriage as far as putting them together. Well, if marriage is a God thing, now listen, God can fix it if you were in that situation, okay? Because you can bring God into your marriage, all right? But I think most of the time God's been there the whole time, orchestrating the whole thing, and put you together, and you just let him out instead of bringing him in. I do think God's in the marriage. And if he's not in the marriage, I don't think you need to be getting married. That might be hard for some people. But if he's not in it, what you doing? You young people. If he's not in it, what you doing? Now, he thinks enough of you. You don't think, if he'll send an angel out in front to prosper the journey of the servant to bring a wife, what do you think he'll do for you? Do you think he'll do that?
Yes.
Or are you just going to say, I'm not sure?
Yes, he will.
Amen, he will. But we have to believe that. We have to walk out in faith. We have to allow that to happen. We have to trust that he will do that, that he'll do that word for you. He'll bring that word to pass for you. And it takes some work. You need to. If you're in that situation where you're looking and you want, I'm not saying everybody has to be married. There's a lot of people, obviously, got married, probably shouldn't have got married. I'm just saying, let God in it. And expect him to bring the miraculous to pass for you. I mean, he sent me her. I guarantee you, I would not be doing what I'm doing today without the Lord having sent her into my life. No, it just wouldn't happen. And for me to think that God wasn't in that the whole time, I'd be foolish. God is in your life all the time. He's working to bring you happiness if you'll receive it. He's working to bring you blessing if you'll receive it. So if you have trouble believing the scripture, tell God, your daddy, and Jesus, your brother, that you need more Holy Spirit intervention to teach you what the scripture says. He promises in the scripture, he sent the comforters so that you could know the scriptures. And part of the time he says, I'm going to tell you, and I'm going to bring it to your remembrance. Now, how many of us get to the point where we can trust that? Where we're so worried about what we're going to say. Oh, I can't go up and talk to that person. I don't know what to say. I'm sure nobody's ever thought that. I'm sure. And yet Jesus promises that if we'll walk up, he'll give us the words.
Amen.
All you got to do is open it. And, you know, the other day I was talking to somebody. I'm down getting herbs from my herb lady. And this lady walks in. And she's a friend of the herb lady. I had seen her down there, but didn't know her. Catherine says, this lady needs prayer. She just lost her husband. I'm thinking, oh, my God. She sits down. She says, I said, you want me to pray? Well, yeah, I want you to pray. So I start talking, and I'm thinking, oh, my God, what am I saying? Because I was really, I talked about her husband being hard-hearted. And this guy just died 7 days ago. And I'm thinking, oh, my God. Because I'm thinking, oh, you don't say that. I don't know the guy. I never met the guy. And she just started crying because it just took the pressure off of her. She knew that about her husband. She knew it had been rough for her trying to get, you know, hey, listen, I feel sorry for you ladies that, like her, that, you know, she was the one that was walking in faith while we were just kind of drug along. Just don't be afraid to speak, because your words carry, are words of deliverance for people. And don't worry about what it sounds like, because sometimes it's going to sound pretty stupid. I mean, I've never walked up to a woman and just lost her husband and said, well, your husband was hard-hearted, if that wasn't from the Spirit. But it was a word of deliverance for her. Even today I'm thinking, yuck. Most of all, we don't do this for our family as much as we do for other people. You know, you believe for a word to speak to some stranger because you know God wants you to speak to a stranger. And he doesn't want you to bring that word to your family, to your wife. Tanya had us do something last night, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where were we?
Yesterday afternoon.
The one last night?
No. Well, yes, at the communion thing, yes, last night. And then we wrote to...
How many of you that made you a little uncomfortable? Oh, yeah.
You should tell the live stream doesn't know. Whoever's listening, they don't know what you're talking about.
Okay, last night Tanya had us, during communion, speak a word. Okay. To speak a word over our spouse. A word from the Lord over our spouse. Okay? I'll be honest. It was more uncomfortable for me. Now, I wasn't in an awful place. I wasn't thinking, oh, my God. It wasn't like that. But it wasn't the same as speaking over somebody else. And I'm thinking, Lord, I'm sorry. Because actually, it should be even more exciting to speak that word over your spouse. So I challenge you. If you were in that place of a little bit uncomfortable last night, talk to the Lord about that. And say, I don't want to be there. I want to be more free with the words that you give to me. I want to speak a blessing. I want to encourage my spouse like nobody I've ever encouraged in my life. And if that's our heart, you think Jesus and God won't come through? And the Holy Spirit just won't come all over you and you'll speak what they need to hear? So, If that's lacking, that's lacking in my life. It's not to the point where I want that to be. But I want to change. In Jesus' name, I want to change. The point I wanted to read this about this guy. You think God wasn't all over that marriage? Getting Isaac a wife? God's all over it. It's God's idea. It's God's business. Let him in on it. Let him in on it. And if you got married without him being in on it, ask him in now. It isn't too late. It's not too late.
Amen.
If you're thinking, oh my God, I shouldn't have done it, it's not too late. Jesus is still the game changer. Okay?
Amen.
You believe it's not too late? Do you believe he can still heal your marriages?
Yes.
You believe that life will be better tomorrow than today? Yes, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, hallelujah. So, you know, I'm sorry for not wanting to be up here. But one of the things I would do, I want to thank you all for your prayers. Because really that is probably a lot of the reason that I am able to do what I do. Michael came in today and said, you know, I've really been praying for you a lot the last couple of years. He didn't know it, but I needed it really bad. I needed that intervention. And God worked on his heart to do that and to tell me that. That's a big deal. That's a big deal to know that the Lord's got your back. You can be messing it up all over the place. The Lord's got your back.
Yeah.
Even like that. The Lord's got your back. He can take care of you. Deliver you. Save you.
Make you whole.
Yes, amen. In Jesus' name. Whole in every way. Well, please pray for and do the love work during your closing. I don't have a closing song. Oh, yes, I do have a... Oh, yes, I do. You're thinking, yes, you better have me play it because I looked it up for you. Yeah, okay, play it.
You just got more wisdom to deal with it. And the next one there, there's no rust
on... Lord, we thank you for your goodness.
Next slide, please, Joey.
He's trying.
What was that? He's working it. There's no rust on the gifts that God gave you.
Hold on.
Right, they don't get old. They don't rust. That Christ in you is just as fresh on the edge of its seat and empowered.
Yeah,
there we go. That was Kevin.
Hey, one. Let's give those guys a big applause. They walk into this blindfolded, basically.
And this is their first solo flight at
South. To do this and. You know, I wouldn't even want to attempt it. So
while they're looking that up, I wanted to personally thank in front of everyone Donna O'Neill, who made 3 trips in to work with Voice of Praise on that awesome song. We worship you.
Eight hours one way.
And so
she drives it.
Mwah.
Yeah.
We love you so.
Well, anyway, Lord, we just thank you for your grace, your mercy. Thanks just for the opportunity that we have to honor you. And let us look at it that way. We're honoring you. We're honoring you. We're letting you know that we appreciate what you've done for us. And we're also letting you know that we believe that there's more. Because who's going to give if they don't think there's any more? Hey, where you at? Thank you, Lord, that we trust you, that we know you, and that there's always more when you're involved. So, thanks for being involved. And if you're not involved as you need to be, help us to let you just work in our lives. Help us to stand aside and watch you perform in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
thought of. And this is how family works.
I stood in the courtroom. The judge turned my way. It looks like you're guilty. Now what do you say? I spoke up, Your Honor. I have no defense. But that's when mercy walked in. Mercy walked in and pleaded my case. Called to the stand, God saving grace. The blood was presented that covered my sin. Forgiven with mercy walked in.
Praise the Lord.
Stood there and wondered, how could this be, that someone so guilty had just been set free? My chains were broken, I felt born again.
For the opportunity to share, and also you might wonder what that song really has to do with this. If we walk forgiven and walk like we're forgiven, we'll be able to carry blessings and shower blessings on others around us, because they're carrying burdens that they don't need to be carrying. And if we're carrying burdens around with us that we don't need to be carrying, we're not going to be able to bring that deliverance that God wants us to be able to do. And we need to walk like we're forgiven. We need to walk like we're forgiven today. So if you're carrying burdens like that, ask for help. Ask for help. Ask for prayer. Ask for Jesus to step in. Because he says he breaks the chains. He's a chain breaker.
Amen. Amen.
He's a chain breaker. I just love that song. He's a chain breaker. Amen.